So I'm recording this workshop, and it looks like it's working this time, which I'm very happy about. Last time we ran the workshop, this didn't work. So when I get home tonight, I'll cut those videos, put them up on YouTube as they are. So I won't do any much editing. I'll just cut them into lessons. And then you have it available there to look at and kind of refresh your memory, or if there are parts that you need to gain more understanding in. So what are we going to do for starters here? The first thing I would like to look at with you is this installation, and we'll be essentially rebuilding this in the basics of it. It's a direct audio visualization of an audio file, and with a lot of these audio visualizations, how they work is that you essentially find parameters in your audio waveform, and then you find parameters in a animation that you want to animate with the waveform. For this particular piece here, this was a screen. It was called Raster. No, it was just called Screen. But it was an installation for Raster Noton in Dresden. And once we're done with it, it will look something like loading up. So it will look something like this. Essentially, a whole bunch of lines that we're animating to the music. And let's get started with that. Just gonna pause this. And yeah, the first step, what we'll do is we'll open up a fresh Touch Designer. Let me get my notes up. Yeah, if you have any questions, if anything is unclear, please let me know right away so we can get you caught up on things. I will not necessarily go over the interface much, so if there is things that are not quite clear, let me know as well and I'll explain them. So if everybody has Touch Designer started, then let's just close down the palette here on this side because we don't need it, and it gives us a little bit more screen estate to work in our networks. And the first thing usually I'll do, I'll just remove this network, and on Windows it's Control A to select all operators and then delete. On the Mac I imagine it's something similar, Command A, or, and we have a nice empty scene here. So the first thing we need obviously is some music, and in the folder that I gave you, if you go into the media section of it, so it's the Workshop 2018-12 Electric Perfume, there's a media folder, and in there is an audio folder. And let's take this track by Zenking and drag it. You can just drag it onto Touch Designer, and it should be looking something like this. Now, if we want to listen to this, we can. The same way that we have an audio file in here that's being created by dragging it in, you can also listen to this track by creating an audio device out. So right-clicking on the output of the audio file in, you get the Upgrade dialog. And from there, we'll choose the audio device out chop. And I can hear that everybody has something.
Oh, okay. I did plug in.
So
Sorry about that. That's oversight on my part. Or is your sound output to HDMI?
To this here, currently. Oh, yeah.
There we go.
Perfect. Cool. So I picked a very articulate track, like with nice waveforms that are not too noisy. The thing with audio visualization usually is you need to find the right visualization for the track. Like, not everything works with every visualization. So this one with a lot of low frequencies lends itself very well to what we're trying to display here, because we have these many waveforms that we try to show. Okay, and you can always, if you have this audio device out, either move the volume parameter down or turn the activate, the active flag off to stop playback. The other thing I usually do is, as a first step, is create a null chop in this chain here as a separate branch. So to create a separate branch, you middle mouse click, and this is where the three button mouse always comes in very useful. Middle mouse click on the output of the audio file in and place the null chop. So we have it separate from our audio device out. If you don't have a middle mouse button by any chance, you can always just create the null chop as a separate operator and then connect them. So as I said, the idea here is that we have a whole bunch of lines and we're animating these lines. So the first step for us would be to create a line SOP, and SOP stands for surface operators. So let's have a look if we can find this. If you hit tab and bring up the opcreate dialog, then up here you have all the families, and let's click on the SOP family and find the line SOP. Here in the center column, the third from the top. And the line SOP, well, yeah, it does what it says. It creates a line, but we can specify the number of points that we want to have on this line. By default, this is 2. And what I would like to have is a little bit more resolution than just 2 points that I can animate. And so for me, I picked 150 points. That should be plenty. And the next step, just to look again at the picture, is that we want to have a whole bunch of these lines. So we want to create copies of these lines. And this can be done with a copy sub. So let's append a copy sub by right-clicking on the output of the line sub and find the copy. Oops. Copy. And the copy sub in general is a great, if you haven't played with it yet, I highly recommend playing with its functionality. By default, you create a bunch of copies, and let's create 270 of them. So type a number of copies, 270. And then what you can do is, you can do this cumulative transform with each copy, meaning those parameters down here, the translate, rotate, scale, will be applied cumulatively to each copy that you create. So for my purpose, I want to move them up a little bit. I want to create many lines on top, like in Y. So what I'll do is I'll change the translate parameter in Y, which is the second parameter here. And I'll change it using my little value ladder, where you can see if I even, like if I go in really slow, small increments by 0.001, I can create something that is close to a 16:9 aspect ratio, but we can change that later. The value ladder, for those of you who haven't used that yet, you can middle mouse click onto a parameter, which brings up this funny little grid here. And now holding the middle mouse button, you can choose the increment value that you wanna change the parameter by. So for me, I moved down to 0.001 increments, and now you can go left and right and interactively adjust this parameter. It's really nice to play around, test out parameters in touch, doing this with the value letter, because you can really dial things in. You don't have to type these numbers in. You can just see, okay, this looks right, this looks about right, this is too much, so go back. It's a really useful tool for quickly exploring what parameters do.
So we just release the middle mouse button to select the value?
Right, and then, yes, so middle mouse click to bring up the value letter. And then, keep middle mouse click and then just drag it left and right. This is a really, really useful workflow that I'll be using all over the place. Does everybody have that? And I mean, if you have trouble with it initially, it's a little bit something that you gotta get used to. I'm using a 0.003 value for now. So the translate y is 0.003. Value letter. Yeah, we call it the value letter. Well, and the next step for me is, because I want to see the result fairly quickly, I want to render this. I want to convert my SOPs, which is 3D data. So SOPs are basically positions in space of points. I want to convert this to pixels. You can kind of explore the difference here. If you click the viewer active button of this copy sub, and then you, with the middle mouse button, you can zoom in here. With the left mouse button, you can tumble in the 3D viewer. And there's a big difference, which we will see in a moment, between this viewer here, a sub viewer, and the rendered scene, which would be a top viewer, where we just have pixels. So to render a scene, what we need is a geometry component, a camera, and a render top. So the way that I usually go from here is that I right-click on the output of the sub that I want to render, and I'll go to the component family and pick a geometry component, and then place it. What this does for me is it does a whole bunch of setup that I otherwise would have to do manually. It places the geometry component, but it also creates an input to the geometry component. And then if I go inside, and you can go inside by zooming, it's the zoomable interface in Touch Designer, you see that you have an in sub and an out sub. And the out sub has the all-important render flag set, the render flag being something that needs to be activated for this operator to actually be converted into pixels to be rendered. So theoretically, you could set it up all manually, but it's a nice shortcut to just right-click on the output of the sub you want to render, go to the component family, and pick the geometry component. So the other component I need is the camera. So let's hit tab and find the camera in the component family here. And everything related to 3D geometry and rendering is in this first column here. So let's pick the camera, not to be confused with the camera blend. And last but not least, we need, oh, it's not actually last but not least, second last, we need the render top. So hit tab again, go to the top family, which is texture operator. So that's everything with pixels, and find the render. Now we still don't see anything, and this is because we don't have a material or a light assigned. And while with a lot of renders, like the render is currently black, while with a lot of rendering you will need a light for certain types of materials, the material we will choose is a constant material, which basically says that this geometry has a constant color. We don't need light for this, and we don't need light because we're just creating lines that don't have any specific reflection or anything. So let's place a constant material, hit tab and go to the material tab, find the constant mat. And now we need to tell the geometry to use this constant material. And we can do this by assigning this constant or referencing this constant mat in a material parameter that sits with the geometry component. So select the geometry component, go onto the render page in the parameters, and drag the constant material onto the material parameter. And you should be seeing a little white square in your render. Just as a little reminder also, if your parameters are not up, you can always bring them up with the P key. Hide them with the P key or bring them up with the P key. And this will show you the parameters of the currently selected node. So if I switch around in the operators here, my parameters switch around as well. If you ever want to have a parameter window up as a like constantly as a floating window, then you can just right click and onto an operator, and then it has a parameters menu entry, and then you could stow this window here on the side. Now this one doesn't change, it will always have the parameters of the operator where you open it from. Does everybody have that? Great. So, well, this little white square here, it would be nice if I could see this square as the whole, like filling the whole screen. So, a lazy way to do this would be essentially to use the translate or transform parameters on the geometry component to just scale and translate this into place. And now what I could do, I could try to move this into the center by moving the translate minus 0.5, translate in X direction. And now I want to scale it. And what's happening is you see that it's scaling to the right. It's not scaling center from the center point. And this is due to the transform order that you have in the that you have a parameter for in the geometry component. So the transform order currently is set to scale, first scale, then rotate, then translate. So whatever I do here, even though I moved it first into the middle, my scale will be applied first, meaning if I change this back to zero here, it's scaling from the center because that's where my pivot is. So it's scaling to the right. And only then it's applying the transform. So this is a little bit difficult now to get right, to get the right translate and scale. But we can change the transform order to something like translate and then scale. So let's do that. Transform order to translate, scale, and then rotate. So now we can move it to minus 0.5 to have it in the center. And now if I change the scale, it's scaling from the center point. and I can make it fit into my viewer here. And I can move it a bit down. And I'll just do this roughly. We can, you can dial that in later and scale it up. So you should be seeing something like this. The values that I came to is the translate is minus 0.5 in X and minus 0.4 in Y. And the scale in X is 4.2 and the scale in Y is 2.69. I always forget to save, but it's sometimes a good idea to save. So go to the file menu and there's various ways to save. If you just hit save right now, it will save it as a file called new project on your desktop, but you could also choose save as to put it into a specific folder with a specific name. Or you can use the create project folder where it creates a folder for you. I'm just going to use the save as and make a new folder here. AudioVis. And save it as a file that I call AudioVis. Now every time you hit Control S, it's going to save a copy of that file into this folder. It might be worth explaining a little bit. You can always look at the folder where you saved the file by going to the Help menu and where is it? What? It's not there anymore. Somebody. Oh, it's in dialogues. For some weird reason, it's in dialogues. If you click on Explorer there, then it will open up the file location with the files you have there. Okay. Well, similar to what I do here with the audio file where I put a null chop to it, it's also a good idea to put a null top after the render. So let's right click on the output of the render and add a null. And this will be the last node basically where we can view it from the final result. The null does nothing essentially, but it's good for organization. Exactly. Yeah. So you have an endpoint that you set, and you can do anything in between the render and the null, but you always have this null to look at or to reference. Otherwise, what sometimes happens is, especially in shops, but also it's generally in all operator families, you might reference something from which is not a null, and then you need to add more functionality after, and now you need to reroute your network because now your last operator has moved in that chain. So it's a good organizational tool to always have a null as your last operator. Okay, so the idea of animating these lines here is that I will take the amplitude of my audio file, and for each sample that I have here, I would like to create a sine wave where I control the number of cycles in the sine wave. The number of cycles, so you have to imagine that we'll take this waveform here and we'll turn it 90 degrees, visually, not technically, just visually speaking. And then we'll take each of these samples and use it as a number to control the number of cycles of a sine wave. And then use each of these sine waves to offset these points here of our copies. Sounds hard to explain, maybe, but watch this, it's not too hard to actually do. currently I have a stereo signal, but for our purposes we just need mono. And an easy way to move this into mono, which works with most files, is to average the signal. There's probably better ways, and somebody with more audio knowledge should explain to me how to do a proper mono signal. Because I don't know if you have phase offset, like some people like to work with phase offsets in their sound. If you average the signal, you probably sometimes end up with nothing. So I have no clue how to actually make a proper mono signal. But here we go. The way that I would do this currently is put a mass chop in between the audio file in and our null chop. Now there's many, many ways to insert something in between here. One would be to move with your mouse over the wire, right click, and choose insert operator, and then pick a mass chop. And the mass chop has a bunch of functions, and one of them being the ability to combine channels. So under the combined channels parameter, you can choose average, giving us a single channel.
The best way I've seen stereo turned into mono ever. Like in the audio world, that would be amazing if you could do that.
If that would be always correct. Yeah.
We could also just select one of the channels.
You could also just select one of the channels. Yeah, absolutely. Now let's have a look a little bit about what we're dealing with here. Our whole project is by default set to run at a frame rate of 60 frames per second. So we're rendering 60 frames per second. Audio generally, and we can look at this if we middle mouse click onto, for example, the mass chop, the sample rate of audio that we brought in here is 44,100 samples per second. This translates to something that's mentioned here, 735 samples. Now, how is that calculated? If you have 44,100 samples per second, you're rendering at 60 frames per second. So you take the 44,100 divided by 60, you end up with 700, like a frame worth of data, of 735 samples. So the audio comes in at the sample rate, and now per frame, we're getting 735 samples. To work with this data though, it would be much more useful to not have the sample rate that the audio gives us, but to resample it to a rate that we work in Touch Designer, to the 60 frames per second. And we can do this with the resample chop. So after the mass, right-click on the output and find the resample chop. And by default, the resample chop takes the incoming data, converts it to 60 frames per, to a sample rate of 60, sample rate, 60 samples per second, and it collapses almost all of these samples that we're currently getting, the 735, into one single sample. So we're left with only one sample, which is not enough for what we need. we actually need much more data, since we want to animate each line separately. Each line that we created, we want to animate with a single sample. So we need as many samples as we have copies of lines here. And to do this, this is a little bit of a funny one. All of these parameters here are disabled currently. And this is because on the common page of the resample job, there's a parameter called time slice. Now, time slicing is something I do not like to explain, but going onto our wiki, and you can always get to our wiki by clicking on the little help on the question mark here, and clicking, you're taken to the resample shop page, and there's a whole article about where you can learn about time slicing. Is essentially a technique where Touch Designer tries to make sure that if you fall behind with your frame rate, like you cannot hit the 60 frames per second, that it's still calculating the values that you need of the frames that you missed. This is especially important for animation. If you have an animation curve that's being calculated every frame, and now you're missing frames, you would see jumps in the animation. But what time slicing basically does, it still calculates those values for the missing frames, giving you a smooth curve, essentially, avoiding those jumps. That's probably the simplest explanation of it.
There's also the option hover over time slice to go into the wiki from the interface.
Oh, that's a good point. Yes, we added that in. If you hold Alt, if you hold the Alt key and roll over a parameter, it gives you a little explanation of the parameter. I forget about this. Yeah, if you want to know what these parameters actually do, either go to the wiki or hit the Alt key, hold the Alt key, and you can kind of see the same information that's on the wiki in a short form. So the important thing is turn time slice off on the common page of the resample job. And now we have all these parameters available. They're all being enabled, or the method at least. And what we want to do is we want to have a new rate of 60 frames per second. And we want to have a new interval, because here we have 735 samples, but all we need is 270 samples, because we need one sample per line that we created. So let's choose method, new rate, new interval. And what we get is the unit values menu comes up. And let's switch that from relative to start end to absolute. And now we can specify a start point and an end point of our signal here. Meaning we can tell it essentially the length to which it should conform to. Start 0 and end now. You see, if we increase that in the viewer, you can actually follow how long the signal becomes. So if I set that to end 10, you're going to end up with 600 samples here, because this parameter, this end parameter, is using a unit of seconds. So let's switch the end unit parameter to samples. And now we can type in our value that brings us to 270 samples, which would be 269. Why 269? Because we're zero-based in Touch Designer, mostly. So 0 is the first sample. And to get 270 samples, you need a length of, the endpoint would be 269. And we can double-check that this is OK by middle mouse clicking onto the resample chop. And now we see, okay, our sample rate is 60 samples per second, and the length of this channel is 270 samples. All right, good time to save. I do often, this resample thing is something to just practice, essentially. You get an audio signal. If you want to use that audio signal in an audio visualization, most likely you're going to resample it down to 60 frames per second. The lengths that you then specify depends on what you want to do with it. For our specific purpose here, we trimmed it down, or we scaled it down to 270. But
as soon as we put the resample on there, it's already at 60 frames per second.
Yeah.
So we're just adjusting, I guess, the length.
And then we're just adjusting the lengths. Yeah, exactly. Okay, gonna move this a little bit to the side here. And now, as I said, what I wanted to do is animate these lines with waveforms, with sine waves, and control the number of cycles of the sine waves depending on the amplitude of each sample here. So let's create all of these sine waves. And a quick way to create those would be by choosing a pattern chop. So hit Tab to bring up the Upgrade dialog and find the pattern chop. The pattern chop is a really nice, simple tool. It lets you specify various waveforms. So sine, cosine, can create triangle waves, square waves. We'll stay with sine for now. You can specify a length. So it's very simple to say how long this channel should be. And then is this parameter here, which I want to control later, which is number of cycles. Now, the length for our sine wave here, if I want to apply this sine wave as the TY offset, as the Y offset of this line, then this sine wave needs to be the same, or needs to have the same number of samples as I have points in my line. So when we created this line, we created it with 150 points. So let's set the length of this sine wave here to 150. And the number of cycles we'll control dynamically later, with an amplitude here from the audio. But now we need not just one sine wave, but we need as many sine waves as we have lines here, because every line will get one sine wave to animate with. So how do we create multiple sine waves? Well, we can go onto the channel page of the pattern shop, and then just use, chan would be the base name. And then I use the open square bracket. And now I can write a range in there, how many channels should be created. So I can say 1, 2, and we need 270. And hit Enter. 1 to 270, and then close square bracket. Can also bring up the magnifier, maybe. So Chan, which is the base name, then 1 to 270 is basically the index of all the channels we're creating. And if I look at my channels now here in the pattern chop, I can see that it created all these copies of these channels, 270 channels.
So is there any reason here you have to use base 1, starting from 1?
this doesn't matter actually. You could also do 0 to 269 or any other range, just so that you get end up with 270 channels in the end. And also this chan here, the base name is totally, you can make this whatever you want. Like this could be my chan. And now you see that they're all called my chan 0 to 269. So my next step would be that each cycle here, for each waveform, I want to control the number of cycles. Currently, when I move this parameter, all of the channels change the same way. But I want the first channel to have the number of cycles. Let me just pause this. So my first channel should have the number of cycles of my first sample here. My second channel should have the number of cycles of the amplitude of my second sample here. Maybe if I zoom in a little bit, that makes more sense, and put hit D to see all the samples. So the first channel gets the number of cycles of the value of this sample here. The second channel gets the number of cycles of the second sample, the third of the third sample, and so on. And to do this, I need to put a little expression into this parameter. So let's try that. We'll be doing a little amount of Python in this, no major programming, just to get you accustomed to a little bit of Python. So when we do, when you do scripting in Touch Designer, then we previously were using TScript, a language that came from Houdini, called HScript there. But then some years ago, we embedded Python into Touch Designer. So all the scripting now is done in Touch Design, in Touch Designer is done in Python. So let's try that. What we want to do is, depending on my current channel index, I want to grab a different sample from this null one operator here. So first, let's to get into the scripting mode here, click on number of cycles onto the name, and what opens up is a little other field, which makes it a bit easier to type expressions into this parameter. So first I need a reference to this null one chop. And to create these references, you start with OP. Let me just zoom in again. OP for operator, then open parentheses, single quote, and now the name of the operator. So the name of my operator here is null one. So let's type null one. And what this gives me is a reference to the operator. When you do Python in Touch Designer in parameters, what's nice is you can highlight parts of the expression that you're typing in. And when you roll over, Touch will tell you what it's evaluating to. So here, up null one is evaluating to a null chop reference, which is located in project one null one. So now I have access to the whole chop. Now I want to get to the channel. And I only have one channel here. And to get the channel access would be open square bracket and then an index. So 0, because we only have one channel, and close square brackets. So highlighting this and rolling over will tell me, oh, okay, now I have access to a channel object here. The channel essentially is a list of values. Like I have, because I have those 150 values in my channel, 270 values in my channel. Basically, this object here is a big list of all these values. And now with the square bracket again, in here, I can get access to a specific value in that big list. And this big list, I wanna get access to specific ones depending on which channel is being evaluated currently in my pattern shop. And to do this, I can type me being the pattern shop itself, dot, and then it's chan index. So depending on which channel it's looking at, it's going to pick a different sample from my null shop. Yeah.
Let's say I was working in a different shop. How would I find those variables or what they're called?
Yeah. If you want to see what's available to each shop or to these parameters, then there is the Python help button on the parameters, and this takes you to the shop class that is for this specific shop, and then you have these members here. So you have chan index and sample index as members for this specific shop. But then there's also for the shop class itself, which is common to all shops, you have all these members here. Number of channels, for example, it's the length, number of samples, and then various methods. And here you can see, oh, okay, I have a method here which gets me access to a channel. This is what we used to get to a specific channel and a couple other methods. So yeah, if you want to know what Python is available on an operator, then that's the best. The Python help is the best way to get to that. Yeah.
Is referring to channel 0, 801? Is that what's happening?
That's correct, yeah.
Okay. And then the next one is the sample index.
Yeah.
Within
that channel, yeah. So the first part here is a reference to an operator.
Yep.
Then the operator has a list of channels because it's a chop. So now we're looking at the first channel, which again gives you a list of values of samples. And this gives us now access to a specific sample. And the specific sample we look at depending on which channel in the pattern shop is being evaluated at the time.
So in this case, maybe we should have named it's just confusing because in the pattern, you're using channels and you're mapping the channels to a sample within one channel.
Yeah.
Confusing.
Yes.
And in this case, if we had named our channels from 1 to 270, would we have gotten an out of bounds error?
No. The chan index itself is independent from the name. So it's first channel is 0,
yeah.
Second channel is 1. And the channels could be named TX, TY. The chan index is still integer list.
Okay, so in this case, it really didn't matter what we named the channel.
Correct, yeah. Could have been anything. Yeah. You can get to, you could be using the names to look up stuff as well. So with the, because you have the chan index, you could get to the actual channel name and then start using that, but for this it's just the index. So my next step would be, if I look at my channels here, those number of cycles, usually you have one sine wave would be a cycle of one, So I probably, my current values where I'm feeding this number of cycles parameter with, it's an audio waveform. So the value range is between minus 1 and 1. It's a normalized value range. I probably want to make this something where I shift my values up to be between 0 and 1 and also scale them so that I can get at a minimum maybe, at a minimum no cycle, but at a maximum maybe I want to have 10 cycles or something like that. So we can change the values of this channel here with another mask chop. I'm going to move this here to the side. And after the resample, I'll add another mask chop. So I'll right click on the output of the resample, find a mask chop, and now I have various ways of changing this. The easiest way for me usually is to use in the mask chop the range page. The range page does a remapping of a value range. So you can go from, you know your from range, which would be minus 1 to 1. That's the incoming range. And I can map this to a value range of 0 to, let's say 0 to 10, for example. That would be one way. I could also, the other way that might be more useful here actually, is to leave my range page alone. So it's 0, 1 is 0 to 1. And on the op page of the mask chop, I could change the channel pre-op operation to making all the values always positive, because my amplitude in an audio waveform, perhaps I could just interpret this as always positive values. So now you see that the channel before it was minus to plus range, and basically everything that's now in the minus range, in a negative range, is being mirrored up into the positive range. So it's an absolute value. And with that, with the channel pre-op set to positive, at the range I change back to the default value, 0101, I can go to the multi-add page and just multiply the signal by 10, for example. Or even higher, by 20. I'll just move all of this a little bit to the side. So the next question would be, now I have all these channels here, and if you scroll down this list a little bit, and to scroll I would have to activate the viewer of my pattern shop. So click the little viewer active flag on the right bottom side, and then I have my scroll bar here. And you can kind of see that they are certainly different from each other. So now I want to use these channels and apply those values, the amplitude of each of this channel, to my TY position of each of these lines here. So I want to animate this line to basically look like this first channel. And the way I can do this is by converting these SOPs, those surface operators, convert them into chops. So I get all point positions as chop values. Then I add the pattern onto those chop values and then convert the whole thing back into SOPs. This is a really strong point of Touch Designer, that you can convert between these families, family types. Data of 3D data that you have in SOPs can be equally displayed as channels, as point positions, essentially. Let's try that. Hit Tab and find a sub 2 chop. So what we would expect from this sub 2 is all the geometry information that we have in a sub. So I'll place the sub 2 right below the copy and take the copy sub and drag it onto the sub parameter of the sub 2 chop. That's a lot of subs in one sentence. And what I get from it is three channels, TX, TY, TZ. And these three channels describe this geometry here. So if I zoom in, I can see I have my TX is for each line. It's going up to the right, basically. Then I have TY, which is stepping. So for every line, I have a constant TY, but then it steps to the next line, steps to the next line. And it's a flat geometry, so TZ is zero. And I do realize here that I have a little problem. I want to apply these channels here to the TY channel. Like I want to add those onto the TY so that all these points are being offset by my animated channels. But I have one TY and I have 270 of those channels here. So I have to combine them somehow. I have to sequence all these channels into one long channel. And this sequencing can be done with a shuffle chop. So let's right click on the output of the pattern and find the shuffle. And the shuffle chop has a bunch of methods that it can act on channels. We just want to sequence all channels into one long channel. This is what we want to create. So it takes the first channel, sorry, it takes the second channel, puts it at the end of the first channel, takes the third channel, puts it onto that, and etc. pp. Just creates one long channel out of all of these. The shuffle chop, by the way, becomes extremely useful for if you're ever dealing with LEDs as well. You will come across the shuffle chop for various reasons. Definitely something to keep in mind. So what I get is, out of these 270 channels with 150 samples each, I created one long channel with 40,500 samples. 40,500 because 270 channels times 150 samples each creates one long channel when sequencing them together of 40,500 samples. And now it looks like much easier. I have, if I middle mouse click onto my sub 2, I have the same length here. I have 40,500 samples in this chop. This chop has the same length. So combining them together sounds like this should be something that's possible now. And this combining can be done with a mass chop. So you can use a mass chop to actually combine multiple chops as well. Previously, here, we used a mass chop to combine two channels. And now we want to use a mass chop to combine two chops. So let's add a mass chop at the output of the sub 2. Right click on the output of the sub 2, find the mass chop. And the mass chop, if you look closely at the input of the mass chop, you see that this input is slightly wider than the input of a regular other chop. And these wider inputs indicate that you can connect as many other chops as you want. There's a theoretical limit, but not a practical limit. So we can take the output of the shuffle chop and plug it into the input of the math, and now I have both of them connected. And the math chop in the parameters has a parameter called combine chops, where I can choose what to do with those two chops, like how would I like to combine them. And here I'll choose add. So I want to add this chop onto this chop. And I see another problem that I've created for myself. Because what's happening is I have three channels in the first chop and one channel in the second chop. And now by adding them together, it takes the second channel here and adds them onto each of these other channels of my first chop. So I'm now animating TX, TY, and TZ. Not that I don't want to do this, because all I want to do is I want to animate only TY. I only want to offset my TY points. And to get around this, there's an option in the math chop where it says either match by channel number, which is the default, or by channel name. So if I match these two by channel name, it's going to take the first chop. Look, oh, okay, I'm called TX. Can I find a channel TX in my second chop and add them together? No. Is there a TY channel? Nope. Is there a TZ channel? Nope. So currently it's not doing anything. It's just taking the first input. The result of this would be if I rename this channel here to TY, then there would be a match between the first TY and the second TY, and they would be added together. So let's right-click on the output of the shuffle chop and find the rename. And let's rename. We just have to type this into the two parameter. Let's rename this one to TY. Now my TX is still the same, TY is being affected, TZ is zero, not affected. Principally, that's what I want. Because what I can do now is I can take these channels here and apply those values back to the geometry. Here we take the sup, convert it into a chop. We manipulate the chop. And now we can go back. We can just use these channels. And the same way that we converted a sup to a chop, we can also convert a chop to a sup. So first, let's put a null here, because a null is always useful. And then in between the copy and the geo component, let's add the equivalent of the sup to chop, which would be in our case now a chop to sup. So right click on the output of the copy and find a chop to sup. Chop to. There. And the chop to comes up with an error by default, because it doesn't have a chop parameter. It's not being referenced. So I can take the null that I just created and drag it onto the chop parameter. And what you get is a little bit of crazy animating geometry. You should be seeing something like this. Yeah.
Couple things. First off, my shuffle chop is resampling the wrong
22,800 samples per pit.
Okay. So the craziness of this, maybe hit save. Save is always good. Control S. The craziness of this animation currently comes by the virtue of the amplitude of our waves that we're creating here. In the shuffle, we're creating sine waves that have an amplitude of 1. So all these offsets here are by a value of 1, and that's way too high. If you take this down to much smaller values, like 0.05, you get much closer to something that we want to look at, or even 0.01. And once you have that, you can already see similar patterns of what I showed you before. So you have control over the offset via the amplitude of the pattern shop. Can be very small, or 0.01 might be a good value here. Now the whole thing is a little bit hectic, and in the version that I have here, it's definitely not hectic. It's more like it's flowing more. So how this is done is by using a filter chop, where I'm basically not letting the amplitude change so much, but every sample I'm gonna filter. I'm gonna say, okay, to go from one value to the other, you should be taking some time. don't have these crazy movements. So we could do this in various places. Actually, not that many places. Let me just turn this off again, the display flag. So just before the null chop here, let's add a filter chop. So where you have your the null that's feeding the pattern chop, that's referenced in the pattern chop. Before that, let's add there a filter chop. Filter. And what the filter does by default is it takes the whole value range and filters that. Like it it creates a single sample output. Not what we want. We don't want to filter the whole channel. What we want to filter is each sample. So each change of each sample should be filtered for us. And this can be done by setting the filter per sample to on. So now you see the difference here. This is moving quite quick, and this is really lagging. Like it's a very, very laggy signal. And now my animation here is also extremely lagging behind. But I can control this with the filter widths. I kind of can adjust how responsive this whole thing should be. So I can dial this into something that I like, that fits my music, from very responsive and crazy to pretty laggy. And if you don't like what the waveform looks like, you could also play around by changing the pattern type from sine to triangle, which is pretty similar, to square. A little bit more of a, I don't know how to call this. Is that an electric look? Pulses, Random won't do anything. Random is just random. A little bit of joy division, yeah. But I'll leave that as a sign for now. Okay, last but not, sorry, yeah. Does everybody have that? And are there questions of what we did? Yes.
When I added the filter drop, it dropped my frames per second to like 2.
Did you turn on the filter per sample?
So what happened was that because we had same rate, mm-hmm. the rate was still 44,100.
Yep.
And so it has a way more massive amount of samples mm-hmm. to calculate. Thank you.
Does this whole system kind of make sense, what I did here? Like how I use, yeah?
Is there a difference between using a copy and using an instance? Like, is an instance faster?
So an instance wouldn't be for, so what an instance is, you take a geometry and you copy it to the GPU, and then you copy the instance itself on the GPU. So you cannot change the points of the instance anymore. So you would only have one line that would be recreated many times. You could use, what you would have to do then is use a shader, a GLSL shader, to offset the points of each instance. That's the, which would be faster. But more work, more typing. in general, when you think about creating an audio visualization, then often I approach it like this. I look at what can I do with an audio signal, and maybe what parameter can I adjust with. Like really simple things like amplitude, or you could convert an audio signal into a spectrum and then use the spectrum values to change parameters of a geometry, for example. So when thinking about an audio visualization, you look at the audio signal and you try to imagine, okay, what can I do with that? And just to show you a similar example, it's following exactly the same it's following exactly the same thing I'm just adjusting, or I'm just using a different parameter in the geometry. That's something nice that kind of messes with your eyes. Why doesn't it update? Okay. So it's again taking the amplitude of an audio signal, and then I'm using the twist sub to twist. It's a rectangle. Sorry about that. Yeah, and so it's a rectangle, and I'm twisting the rectangle by the amount of the amplitude of each sample. We use this, the amplitude, to change the number of cycles of a waveform. I'm just using the twist parameter of the twist sub and control the amount of the twist per copy depending on the amplitude.
That's really nice.
And it creates an audio visualization that kind of works very well for a certain audio again. You cannot do that for everything.
This is fucking my tinnitus.
Oh, sorry, tinnitus. I just can't tell them apart anymore. So it's okay.
I can't tell what was my tinnitus and what was the song.
Yeah, so it's playing around. It's trying to find things that you can that fit to a song. And I in the folder that I gave you, there's a link to a collection of audio visualizations. This one here works pretty well too.
Rest in peace.
Yep. This just takes the audio as the amount that I offset an extrusion. So it's a very direct translation of an audio waveform as well. And then I turn it 90 degrees, and that creates this with some lighting, but nothing difficult, essentially. And just to show you a couple more. Right. Very simple particle. Again, if you have the right track, this is a one-to-one translation of an audio waveform into a XY scope with particles.
So really sparse productions work a lot better.
Yes. Yeah, complex, or if you would use a pop song or something like this, you would have trouble with an audio visualization. But a lot of the electronic music is very, lends itself very nicely to strange. And I'll show you one more, which also works really well. Okay, two more, because this one is really well. This one works well too. This one uses the copy sub. This one takes the audio waveform and puts it onto a single line, and then I just use the copy sub and rotate this one single line and copy it, like, I don't know, 100 or 200 times. But simple, but it works for me. And last but not least.
So that was the rotation. functional transformation of a whole bunch of lines like we did here.
Yeah. I don't know why my computer is always doing these weird things, but this is what it is. Let's see. And those files you can find on the link that I left in your folder. This is more. This actually doesn't have any geometry. This works with displacements in just in tops, just in pixels. So yeah, there's a little GitHub folder with these audio visualizations in there, and you can just explore different ideas essentially that don't always look good, but you have to find the track for it, basically. There was one more thing I want to do with you here though. If this technique kind of makes sense and gives you a good idea of how I'm using amplitude here to control geometry, to make this look a little bit nicer, once you have a system down, a lot of the things that you end up doing then is trying to make it look maybe more interesting. Or so, for example, here you have a lot of what seems like shadows, and these shadows are created by also assigning color by using the waveform again and assigning it as color to the geometry. What we have done so far is we used the waveforms that we created and assigned it as positional values, but geometry also can have a color attribute. So we can use the same waveform that we use for the offset to also change the color of the geometry. So let's try that. Sorry, I should just shut down this whole thing. Okay. So what we would want to do is the chop 2 itself has a various attribute scopes. So it can change positional values, which is these P attributes. But if you click on this little arrow at the after the attribute scope parameter here, you can see that you also can control color, the color attribute of the geometry, the normals, and UV, texture coordinates. Not that we want to control texture coordinates or normals for this, but it's a possibility and it's useful in a lot of cases. What we would also want to control is color. And if I click on this, it's basically giving me CD as an attribute, and it's now complaining that there is more attributes defined than channels that I'm passing in. So it expects more channels. It expects, currently my channel scope is TX, TY, TZ here. Now by defining CD, it's expecting 4 more channels for red, green, blue, and alpha. And we can just use the same channel that's creating the offset. We'll use the same thing, probably mask it a little bit, like change the range a little bit of it, and then pass it in as color information. So after the rename, let's add a new branch, and you can add a new branch always by middle mouse clicking on the output of the rename. And let's just put another rename there. And let's rename this TY to color. And my next step would be, I somehow have to get this this new color channel. I somehow have to get it into this null chop, which is being referenced by the chop 2 here. And this is also a good case where the null chop comes in very handy. If I would reference this chop 2 here from this math, and now I wanted to add more channels in, now I would have to start juggling and doing stuff. This way here, this reference will never be broken, but I can merge this channel into these three channels with a merge chop. So after the mass 3, just before the null that goes to the chop 2, let's add a merge chop. It's called merge. And the merge chop, similar to the mass, has this multi-input connector. So I can take my color channel, which comes out of the rename 2, pass it into the merge. And now my null here has 4 channels. What's left to do for me is that I have to define the channel scope. So TX, TY, TZ go to position X, position Y, position Z. And then there's this color attribute scope, which expects 4 channels. So I'll just type color, 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 4 times. And because my values are very, very low, they're between minus 0.01 and 0.01, I probably want to add a mass chop after this rename here. So let's add a mass chop. And just multiply the signal until you can see something again. And now you have control over the whole look here by a couple different parameters that we should point out maybe. And sometimes what's useful, if you want to mark down operators where you have parameters that you can adjust, if you hit C in your pane, a little color pop-up comes up in the bottom left. And now you can select the node and color that node. So I can make this mass red, for example. I change this mass, it's called mass 2 for me, it's in front of the filter. And this controls the number of cycles that I get. So here, for example, I can have control over how many cycles I get per, as a maximum.
I have a question about the outputting of this to the screen. Mine has the checkered background.
Oh, yes. I always forget about that. So the checkered background indicates alpha. And there is a preference that I always set, and I never mention it. So if you go to Edit Preferences, on the tops page of the preferences, there's a viewer background. And by default, the viewer background is set to a checkerboard. So it looks like this.
Okay.
And yeah, if you set to black. So I have this mass 2 here after the resample, which controls how many cycles approximately are being created for each waveform. So I can get very dense things, or oops, minus 5 doesn't work. This is better. Can adjust that. Then you have the pattern chop, which would be useful to mark, because here you can change the amplitude of the whole thing? And yeah, those are the main two, I guess, for this one. A fun exercise or something to play around with this as well is if you don't use audio as an input, but use an audio oscillator as an input. So Touch Designer has an audio oscillator chop where you can create simple, simple waveforms essentially, but audible. If I would listen to this here, for example, it would sound like a, what's the default, 440 hertz sine. And if I connect this instead of the audio file, I can create all kinds of different, simple patterns with just oscillators. The funny fact, and we'll look at this in a, are we looking at this? I'm actually not sure. The audio oscillator has a pitch input, a pitch control input. Well, it's okay. Maybe also multiplying those. I had this going better previously. Let's see. Combine channels. Multiply. It's okay. Let's see if in the other file I have that. Let's see. Sine 10, amplitude 0.19. I'll copy. Put this in here. Just gonna put a null here, just for you to give you the idea that playing around with these things can be fun. But it totally doesn't work the way I want it to. Doesn't matter. Yeah, meh. Yeah, so coloring the notes is when you hit C, you get the little color pop-up in the bottom left. So the file that's in your folder holds this setup where I was able to create these patterns. Might be worthwhile investigating what I did there. Basically, yeah. It's just a simple audio oscillator that now creates that. And it's the AudioWiz 03. Okay, any questions for this? Because this would be the end of this lesson. Yes?
Oh, sorry, it's very specific. I think I missed a step, so.
Oh, okay, yeah. What is it? Should I come look, or?
Perfect.
just as a yeah, high level.
Well, it's quite nicely I meant to point that out actually. So we're using 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different families. Yes, except for dots, we're using every family here, so that's a pretty good thing to go over right now. The idea is that even by looking at the viewer, you can kind of already tell the difference between all of them. Chops are for animation data, for values, for audio, for animation channels, control data, like if I have a button attached and I wanna, or if I have a, there's, for example, there's a mouse in here and the mouse in gives me the position of my mouse on the screen. So these kind of data comes in via chops and is processed in chops. So I can multiply this with something, I can filter those values. And then those values usually are used to drive parameters of other operators or used as animation data as we did to offset geometry. You could also control color with it, etc. And the viewer, there's two states for this viewer. One is that you see this channel with all its sample values here. The other state is looks a little bit different, is when you have a channel that just has one value, then you have this bar graph kind of thing. So, like this. So this indicates I have a channel with one sample, with one value only, while this indicates a channel with many samples. The other family we looked at is SOPs, and SOPs, surface operators, which hold 3D data. This is explorable, so you can have lines, for example, and if you activate the viewer of one of those SOPs, then you see that this lives in a 3D world. So every point of information here is a point in space and its attributes, like color. So we have points that we changed and we changed color. So those are two of those attributes. The other thing would be texturing information, like if I would apply an image to this, then what part of the image is applied to a certain point, for example. Then the big difference to tops, which the render top is, texture operators. While I have 3D here, here my information is just color. So every pixel has 4 values, RGBA, and I have no way of looking at the 3D information anymore because it's essentially gone. Materials that describe how a surface is being displayed and how it reflects light. And components, and those are high level containers, essentially. Containers which often have extra functionality, like the geometry component, which is used to render geometry or to move geometry from model space into world space, for example. And it comes with a bunch of parameters that let me control high-level things like position, scaling, not something we will look at today, but also the geometry component is important for things like instancing, where you copy a geometry and replicate it many, many, many times on the GPU. There is in the folder that I shared with, or on the USB stick, there is the workshop from Mutech in Japan, and they have the files in it that also use or go through the process of instancing. Definitely worth looking at because it allows you to create thousands and thousands of copies of a geometry very cheaply on the GPU. while on the CPU, which the SOPs are currently still CPU based, you have a limit of how much you can do. Yeah, so, and the last family here, which we haven't looked at, is DATS. And DATS is anything that holds, it's kind of spreadsheets or text data that holds scripts, like where you can execute Python scripts from, things like that, yeah. So you have, as a simple example, what it also can do, it can fetch a web page, for example, or you could bring in information that comes from OSC or MIDI, things like that. Yeah. Does that kind of, it's a very quick way of describing it all, but yeah. All right, let's check the time. It's 12. Let's get on to the next lesson here. If you just save this, oh, we haven't even looked at it with music, but I think you get the idea. You can also try this at home. It works. save a copy of your file. And I would go as the next step. I would go into audio analysis a little bit, like looking at what tools are available in Touch Designer to analyze an audio level, an audio signal. What we've done is we took the waveform very literally, like we didn't analyze anything, but certainly analyzing is possible too. So let's start a new file. Just going to close this here and open up a fresh file. Right. One side note that I meant to mention. There is also in your folder, there's a nice little component called frequency modulation. And it would be worthwhile for you to check it out at home. It's not an audio visualization. Well, it is kind of an audio visualization because it visualizes an audio oscillator. But what this does is it takes a camera image, converts these pixels. It's a low resolution, so 60 pixels by 40 pixels. And I convert all these pixels into channels. And then I drive basically a frequency modulation of the audio oscillator. I'm changing the pitch. And then I do the same thing what we just did by changing the TY. But what you get is a little camera image made out of waveforms. So high frequency in brighter. Oh wait, no. Low frequencies in bright spots. And does that make sense? I don't know. Yeah, I thought. Oh, because the screen is dark, which is counterintuitive. Yes, low in the dark, high in the bright spots, and a little bit of control by controlling the bass frequency of your audio oscillator here. You can, can play around with this a little bit. But essentially the same idea, just a different source. Okay.